It's the Jim Kelly Show with Buffalo Bills quarterback Jim Kelly and TV2 sports director Ed Kilgore. Brought to you by Genesee Beer. Boy, could I go for a Jenny now. And the Mancuso family of dealerships. Find out why Jim Kelly chose us.
Welcome once again to the Jim Kelly Show. And hey, we have a lot of good things to talk about, Jim. I was just saying to Jim, long about halftime, it was 21-3, and I was sitting up in the press box in Miami, and I was thinking, I wonder what we're going to talk about on Monday night. I know at halftime you were thinking a few other things, but it turned out pretty good.
That's exactly what I was thinking. What am I going to say on my show Monday? No, not quite. I'll tell you what, when you're down 21-0, you have to start having doubts, but we knew exactly. We only had the ball four times in the first half, and anytime you had the ball four times, and we moved it very well, but we had one blocked field goal and a couple mishaps, but you know, when you go against a team like Miami where that can score at any time, you try to score in every possession.
By the way, how's the ankle? I noticed you were limping around there late in the first half, and is that going to be a problem? Are you going to practice this week like normally? Or?
Well, Frank and him threw the ball today, staying go ball, but I didn't do too much today. It's kind of sore, but I've always had problems with my right ankle, but hopefully it'll just be sore and no broken bones.
Yeah, well, of course, that's the one you push off of, too, so you that could be a concern.
Well, Eddie Abramowski, our trainer Abe, what we call him, I don't know why, but before this game, he sprayed it extra and taped both my ankles a little extra. And after the game, he said, I told you that was going to help because I never get my ankles sprayed because what it does is keeps the tape tighter. But some reason, I don't know why, he just did it this game and it might have saved me from breaking my ankle.
Which is tremendous. Well, Abe, you know, knows a lot more than just how to raise pigeons. You know,
yeah, definitely.
He's a pretty
in the Hall of Fame, too.
He is.
Yeah, he's wondering when he's going to be on the Jim Kelly Show. And I said,
yeah.
Abe, maybe down the line a little longer. Maybe I'll put him on one of these days.
Well, we start out looking at Dan Marino. And, boy, did he get off to a good start. Actually, the Miami offense could do just about what it wanted early.
I knew exactly. This play right there when he threw the slant, he audible to it. And I saw the back shift. And when any time the back shift like they did, it's exactly the same play we have. And I knew the slant was coming. It was just a matter of him putting it in, and that's exactly what he did.
And here's another one to Pruitt.
I think this is the one that was a pretty good, great throw. He just beat Derek to the corner. And Derek's pretty good. He's probably one of our best cover guys, but they have some great receivers. And anytime you get a quarterback that has as much time as Dan has to throw the ball, what he's sacked 10 times, I think, this year so far, and maybe not even 10 times, he's going to complete something. He definitely completed four touchdowns.
What's the rivalry like between you and Dan Marino? I know it has to be more than just the usual. I mean, you two guys, of course, you heard nothing except about how great Dan Marino was when you were in the USFL,
and
he had all the great receivers and that kind of thing. There has to be maybe a special reason for you to want to outperform.
Oh, definitely. Not just Dan Marino, but you look at it, there were six quarterbacks that came out in 1983, in the 83 draft, and I think three or four of them are in our division. So anytime you go against a guy that you know, I mean, Dan Marino's from around my hometown, and it adds a little more to it if we come up with a win. And, you know, playing down the Orange Bowl, we won two games in the last 20 years in the Orange Bowl. That's tough, especially coming back the way we did yesterday. But it definitely makes me feel good.
Well, you had a little problem as we roll the highlights here because defensively, they were putting a lot of heat on you in that first half, too.
They definitely were. Plus, they were covering our receivers very well. You know, some of the times, they were a lot of bump and run, and I think our receivers were just starting to get into the groove where they're getting into the heat. They were getting tired, but they started getting loosened up by the second half. They run their routes a lot better. They were getting separation. I was able to fit the ball in.
Did you feel a little rusty in the first half at all after the long layoff?
No, they just, it wasn't me feeling rusty. It was just a matter of getting the timing down again. And a lot of the plays that they were calling, they had great coverage on. Coach Mark Broda did an excellent job with play calling through the whole game. First half, they made some change-ups in the defense, and I wasn't able to go to receivers I wanted to. And, you know, I got to credit Miami. They did a heck of a job the first half.
What was said at the half quickly here? Marv, I guess, was a little upset at you guys, wasn't he?
Yeah, just a little bit, to say the least. He just told us that don't put in our minds that we think that Miami's better than us, because they're not, and they aren't. We just have to go out there and execute and do the things we're capable of doing. And when you get receivers like I got, Chris Burkett, Andre Reed, and Pete Metzlar's had a great game, and you got guys, Ronnie and Rob Riddick, come out of the backfield. We're capable of putting points on the board. It's just a matter of concentrating and doing it. And the thing is, getting the defense, getting us the ball back.
Well, here we see a good completion to Chris Burkett, who we'll hear from in just a moment. And what was the call here, Jim?
I was fake a play action pass, and we have, I think it's when Chris comes, this is a sideline pass. What they were doing is they're covering our guys outside receivers, sometimes double covering them. And Chris, it's just a matter of getting inside, giving a fake like we run a square, and that's a square and across the middle. And we've been running that a lot. And it's a matter of faking a guy out and going to the corner. And Chris probably runs that route just as good as anybody, if not the best.
Then Rob Riddick, who seems to be, as we talked about before, one of the best subs around. He's got seven touchdowns now in three games, and here he takes it in.
I think Rob, knowing that he is at the top of the league in touchdowns, I think he puts a little more effort into it now. When you know that you're competing with the top in the league, you're going to give a little extra, and I think that's what Rob's been doing. He wants the ball on the goal line, and why not give it to him? He has seven touchdowns already, and he gives that extra little effort.
Did that upset you down in Miami? I know a couple of the reporters were asking about if you were ignoring him in the first half because of the strike and everything.
No, I'll tell you what, once you get on the field, all you put everything else aside. There's no way that, even if it was, you know, Carl Byrum or Rob Riddick, whoever the case may be, if somebody's in the end zone wide open, I'm going to try to hit him if I see him.
Yeah.
Once you get on the field, you got to do what you got to do.
Third and 10 play, you go to Chris for a 16-yard gain. Now, this was after the defense had gotten you the ball back, this again in the second half.
I'm trying to remember, I went to Chris so many times, I don't remember which one it was. Oh, that's a great play by Chris. It was squaring what I was telling you before. He makes a good move like he's going to go to the flag the opposite way of the other one, and he comes across the middle. And we have some receivers that can catch the ball going across the middle. I mean, some players might be hesitant because of the hits, but they do a heck of a job. And Chris with nine catches, I think he was trying to tell me he had 11 catches. Is that what you said, Chris? I don't know where the two other ones came from, but they did a heck of a job.
What was the call on the touchdown now? I think Chris told me after the game that he was actually a secondary receiver on this
play. Yeah, he's definitely a secondary receiver. If you ask him, I told him right before this play, if we're in cover four, which is a three deep zone, I'm going to come to you on a post move. And we've been working on this a lot in training camp and preseason, and it's exactly what happened. They came in cover four. Chris made an excellent move for the post to the end zone, and he catches it, and watch the hit here. He gives a good hit, and if you can see the official waits. I don't know if you know, you can't see him. Official waits to see if Chris holds on to the ball. See right there?
Yeah.
He definitely did. I don't know why he didn't spike it.
Yeah, he started to put the spike down. We'll ask him later about
that. Really.
Then Riddick takes it in again, and this tied the score at 24. Then a big break. Schwede's with the fumble, and here you go to Riddick, 17 yards on a third and five.
Well, Rob,
oh, no, this is the play to read. I'm sorry.
Andre, this is exactly the one Chris caught two plays ago. He runs that, fakes the, like he's doing a square, and runs to the post. And they were giving us a lot of two-deep zone, which is, you know, two-deep coverage, and you have to utilize your outside receivers doing a flag patterns, which is to the corner, the end zone, or corner, the sideline. And every time, like I said, Coach Marchabro did a heck of a job calling the plays. He had the right plays at the right time.
Now the call, third and five, you go to Riddick. It was third and five at the 17-yard line. And what was this call?
Third and five, 17. We're in gun formation. Most of our big plays have been coming out of gun, but it's just a matter of Rob beating him to the corner. And I don't know if I've ever thrown that good of a pass before. I was surprised, even surprised myself. But Rob held on to it, and it's a matter of Rob beating him to the end zone. That's exactly what he did.
All right, now the Dolphins came back then to tie it and sent you into overtime. And I know sitting on the sidelines as you watch that coin toss, knowing the way Marino can move the football, you have to be a little nervous.
Three Hail Marys, I said, a couple of Our Fathers the whole time. But I knew whoever was going to get the ball first had a good opportunity to win. The way both teams were moving it, especially the Buffalo Bills in the second half, we seemed to, I think we scored our first four out of five possessions or something like that. But I prayed that we're going to get the flip. And if you watch Fred Smirlis, when they had a coin flip, you think we won the game. I mean, he was so excited. But yeah. We did get the flip, and we took it down, and Scott Norwood made a clutch kick, and we won it.
Okay, we're going to be back to look at a couple of those plays. Chris Burkett had one of them, one of the big catches, and then the field goal. We'll be right back to look at that in just a second.
This house was a great deal, though, huh?
Ira, isn't this where they filmed the movie Poltergeist?
It looks like the house from Psycho.
Okay, stand back. If you and your mother are afraid, I'll go first. Oh, bad.
Get out!
Boy, could I go for a Jenny now.
There are times when only one beer will do. Smooth, cold-aged Genesee.
This house is almost as good as the one you bought in Amityville.
She could have stayed home. This house is already haunted.
You know, I may be young, but I've struck a number of great deals, and I know a great one when I see one. That's why I chose Mancusa Family of Dealerships.
Chevy Olds Cadillac at Mancuso Chevy Olds Cadillac, Main Street, Batavia. Pontiac Buick GMC at Cousins Pontiac Buick GMC, East Main Street, Batavia. And coming this fall, Ford and Ford Trucks at the all-new Mancuso Ford in Akron.
You know, the way Charlie Mancuso deals, he might even give you this shirt off his back.
Find out why Jim Kelly chose us.
Hon, I saw the doctor today. He said we were smart to come in, but he wants to take more tests.
What does he think the lump is?
He doesn't know. I'm scared. What if it's cancer?
Cancer.
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 Even with today's medical advancements, the thought of facing cancer is still frightening. In my special health series, learn about progress that's being made and lifestyle changes that could help you in living cancer-free.
Wednesday on News Center 2 at 11.
And joining us now, wide receiver Chris Burkett, who had quite an afternoon, as Jim told you, 9 catches, I think 130 yards. Did you really have 11 catches, Chris?
No, I thought I did. They called two of them back, and I ended up with 9 catches.
Actually, the one call, in fact, we'll see it in just a little bit here, but you were called for pushing off, but after I looked at it again, it was kind of questionable.
Yeah, we were both having some type of physical contact. You know, I thought it was on him. But, you know, the referees called it, and down in Miami, you know, you really don't expect to get that one. And, you know, he made a pretty good play. I caught the ball, but, you know, it didn't count.
I think I saw you push off a little bit, but I think you might have been a little mad because the first half they were all over you guys, not just covering you well, but they were interfering a lot, and I think you just got fed up with it. But,
I was trying to get them back.
You caught 9 passes, so no complaining then.
Let's take a look now at one of the catches in the overtime. This one was an 18-yarder that helped set up the touchdown. What was this play, Chris?
Well, this was, actually, they had been playing zone. We had been running this play all game, and he ended up playing man this particular play, and I really didn't see Jim. I didn't know where he was, and I just saw the ball, and I just knew where the ball was, and
it
I came up
both
with a
ways.
Cake.
You know, I didn't see you either.
Yeah, he was
Are
like,
you serious?
He,
not to not
I really
tell
did.
Me. You didn't see
I
him.
I think twice. See, the thing is,
on that particular play.
Yeah, because when you run the squaring route, sometimes the defense line will cross, and I know exactly where it's going to be, and I read the free safety because if free safety's back, I know I have Chris coming across the middle. And that particular time, I remember a guy crossed in front of me, and I had a feeling where he was. And when I threw it, he came back to huddle. He said, "I didn't see you." I said, "I didn't see you either." But you know exactly where he's going to be. It's just a matter of, you know, working together and timing.
Well, it worked. Geez, I didn't even realize I should be nervous up there in the press box.
You shouldn't.
So then, that's right. Then Norwood kicks the field goal. Now, let's take a look. Let's roll another tape here, and we'll see kind of some of the bump and run. I know Judson was giving you a pretty rough time at the line, and here's a nice little square out.
There's a couple of the ones that Chris has. He does a heck of a job on the out patterns. Harry, I don't know if that was a foam or not.
Now, here's the, watch. Uh-huh. Jim, this is the play where Chris was called for the push. A little shove right there.
Yeah, but the receiver can't push him once he's past 5 yards. Isn't that right?
Yeah, that's right. And I think once I passed 5 yards, I think I pushed him a little bit, but.
That's just part of football. I mean, if the official can't take that.
Right.
Now, tell me, I know that Marv Levy got on the whole team a little bit at the half, but I know he had a little something to say to the receivers, too, didn't he?
Well, yes. Well, for one thing, in the last couple of years when we played the Miami Dolphins, the receivers really didn't play a role. I mean, we catch 1-2 passes. And, you know, you can't expect to win when you play against Dan Marino and guys such as that. So we had to, for us to win this ball game, the receivers had to play a factor in this game. You know, we had to make some big plays. You know, when I say big plays, I mean like 20-yard passes, you know, 30-yard passes to get, you know, to move the ball downfield. And we did just that.
But it has to be a confidence builder, I know, for all of you, because a year ago, I know that the coaching staff, and we're not trying to really put anybody down here, but the coaching staff went into this game, approached this game like you had to control the football to keep it away from Marino. The atmosphere this year was a little different. It was sort of like, hey, why don't we have the Dolphins worry about Jim Kelly and Burkett and Reed? And
that's what we're doing. Yeah, I mean, yesterday I knew that the game was going to be determined of time and possession. If you looked at it, we had the ball probably 11 minutes more than they did, and probably about 15 or 16 plays more. We controlled the ball, and that's what we needed to do, to keep the ball out of Dan Marino's hands and their offense. It's not just Dan Marino. I mean, it takes 10 others just like it takes 10 others with Jim Kelly. And as you saw, Chris Burkett had a great game, Andre Reed. I mean, we all worked together. And one big thing that I know Coach said before was that, you know, our running game got us going. I mean, we had to have that running game, and especially near the end, we kept the ball. We brought Riddick up the middle, Carl Byram to the side, Jamie Mueller. Everybody was contributing. That's what we needed.
One of the things that surprised me was the conditioning thing. I thought that by the fourth quarter, you guys would probably start running out of gas, and they've been practicing down in that heat and humidity. You stayed in pretty good shape during the strike, didn't you?
Yeah, we did. We practiced like 4 or 5 times a week, and you know, you really didn't think it would, you know, it would help, but you know, it did. And the outcome, it helped us a lot. We went down, and it was hot. It was really hot, and we were kind of, you know, complaining a little bit, but we just kind of psyched ourselves out, and we knew what we had to do. And we went out, and I think we performed well.
Very hot, very hot.
Oh, really? Well, Chris, tell me a little bit quickly here, the difference in your approach to the game now, what kind of things have made you such an explosive receiver now? When you were a rookie, I know you had plenty of confidence, but there were a lot of things you didn't know, and now I think that confidence is justified.
Yeah, well, that's true. Well, for one thing, as far as myself and Jim is concerned, is that I know him a little better now. You know, he know my moves, and he know exactly where I'm at, you know, on certain plays. So that helps a lot. And you know, I got playing time now. I got a lot more experience, you know, and that helps. You know, and my confidence is, and it's not cockiness; it's just confidence. And I think you got
maybe just a little cockiness.
Well, maybe just a little. But I think a good receiver got to have a little confidence.
Yeah, you got to, especially against the defensive backs, right?
Yeah, against some of the defensive backs in the National Football League, such as like the Washington Redskins, like who will be playing, you know, in the next week, like Darrell Green. I mean, you got to have some type of confidence.
Those guys talk to you during the game? Do they kind of try to fill your head with some doubts, maybe?
Yeah, they do. They try to give you some verbal intimidation, but
do you do any?
Yeah, I give it right back to
them. I knew that was.
But that's what I've learned in the past couple of years, you know. That's what I've learned in the past couple of years to as an experienced receiver, to just block them out and do them the same way that they do me.
All right, and then hope they call a running play so that you can get a shot at them. All right, we're gonna be back with more of the Jim Kelly Show in just a moment.
No, I may be young, but I've struck a number of great deals, and I know a great one when I see one. That's why I chose Mancuso Family of Dealerships.
Chevy Olds Cadillac at Mancuso Chevy Olds Cadillac, Main Street, Batavia, Pontiac Buick GMC at Cousins Pontiac Buick GMC, East Main Street, Batavia, and coming this fall, Ford and Ford Trucks at the all-new Mancuso Ford in Akron.
You know, the way Charlie Mancuso deals, he might even give you the shirt off his back.
Find out why Jim Kelly chose us.
Where is the best pizza in town?
I want to know.
Who makes the best wings, fish fry, or beef on weck?
I want to know.
And so do I. I'm Randy Naughton. Here's your chance to tell me where you find Buffalo's best. Look for my Salute to Buffalo's Best ballot in Friday's Gusto. Pick your favorites around town and mail your choice to me by Saturday, November 14th. Send in your vote and have some fun.
Join the News Center 2's Salute to Buffalo's Best.
We want to know.
Investigation. For News Center 2's John Pauley, it's a word to live by. Pauley knows how to get to the bottom of a shady deal in Buffalo. He's done it before. He'll do it again. No matter what stands in the way, you can count on him to bust it open. News Center 2's investigative reporter, John Pauley. He doesn't just cover the news. He uncovers it.
There's no story that's off limits.
News Center 2, news that hits home.
Now, some of you have probably noticed since Jim Kelly's been here, he makes a lot of bucks. Yeah. I mean, the guy, you know, he does more than struggles by, although the last 4 weeks he hasn't been making a lot. But anyway, you wonder, is he worth the money? Well, our Scott Brown looked into that, and this is Scott's report. Take a look.
Jim Kelly arrived in Buffalo with a flourish and a huge contract.
I go without a prepared speech. Because we're kind of, for some reason, we're kind of low on funds right now.
Now, it's no wonder Ralph Wilson felt that way. That's because at the time, he signed Kelly to the biggest contract in NFL history. 5 years, $8 million, about $1.5 million per season. And the question is anybody worth that sort of money?
I really don't think a salary like that is worth 16 weeks of ball playing.
Yes, I think he is.
I think football players deserve what they get. They have a short season and a short career.
He's right now is the best in the NFL, I think.
So he's worth it?
Absolutely.
Yep.
Sure. Brings a lot of fans into the games and things like that. Sure, he's worth it.
And that's the bottom line here. The bottom line. And believe it or not, the figures show that Kelly has actually been a bargain. Here's why. The Bills' attendance in the year BK, before Kelly, was just under 38,000 a game, one of the worst in the league. Last year, AK, after Kelly, attendance jumped by almost 30,000 a game. Now, some basic arithmetic. An extra 28,500 fans per game, times an average of $20 per person for tickets and food, times 8 home games a year, and voila, $4.5 million more a year for the Bills. Now, even if Kelly was only responsible for half of that increase, he more than paid for himself. A key point to remember here, Jim Kelly is an entertainer. And just as people will pay $20 to see a Michael Jackson to perform, so will they with a Kelly. And so, Ralph Wilson's decision to sign Kelly has turned out to be a good investment, both on the field and in the bank. This is Scott Brown reporting.
Yeah, now see, now you're going to want to renegotiate. I can see it now.
Yeah, I do.
Are you an entertainer? Do you look at it that way at all?
To a certain point, I know the fans pay to see good football, and I've always, ever since I was a little kid, wanted to play professional football, and I've always wanted to be in that business, and hopefully I'm entertaining some people. I'm sure I am, just not Jim Kelly, but 44 other players. I mean, I was a little kid once, and I knew I'd like to see Terry Bradshaw, which was my idol, and I considered him an entertainer, and right now I'm just happy to be in this profession. I'm loving every minute of it.
All right, well, speaking of youngsters, we're going to meet Frankie Saul, who won Jim's Miami Dolphins, the game jersey against the Miami Dolphins. He'll be with us in just a moment.
This house was a great deal, though, huh?
Ira, isn't this where they filmed the movie Poltergeist?
It looks like the house from Psycho.
Okay, stand back. If you and your mother are afraid, I'll go first. Oh, bad.
Get out!
Boy, could I go for a Jenny now.
There are times when only one beer will do. Smooth, cold-aged Genesee.
This house is almost as good as the one you bought in Amityville.
She could have stayed home. This house is already haunted.
There's great news, everybody. The First Lady of Laughs is here, Center Square.
Are you kidding?
Yes, with Joan Rivers back, get set to have a ball.
Yeah, I'd like to say it was Can We Talk?
And look who's blown into town with her. J.J. Starbuck, Jake's buddy the Fat Man, the sultry Terry Copeland. So, who's missing?
It's either Dan Rather or our deluxe burrito.
Hey, the gang's all here, and they're better than ever. The new Hollywood Squares.
Monday at 7:30 on TV2.
Enter a world of excitement, where fantasy comes to life, where the stakes are high and secrets fly. For your entertainment tonight, enter a world of excitement, enter the world of entertainment tonight.
Enter the world of excitement when E.T. returns tomorrow at 7 on TV2.
He's a private eye who's always looking for a client.
I'm not a cop. I'm not a process server. I'm a friend of his.
And his friends are always willing to lend a hand.
You see, are you volunteering to help me on a case?
But sometimes his clients become more than friends.
See, you don't understand. I'm not just looking for any woman.
That's right, because Magnum is looking for you on TV2.
You never told me that. I don't tell you many things.
But we will tell you everything on Magnum, weekdays at 4 on TV2.
And here he is, ladies and gentlemen, Frankie Saw from Williamsville.
Yeah, Frankie.
7 years old.
Well, Frankie, what was your reaction when we announced your name as a winner on our show?
I was happy.
Real happy? What about your little sister? Was she happy too?
No.
No? Why? Because I didn't pick her?
No.
Why?
Because she doesn't understand yet.
How old is she?
3.
Did you want to say hi to her?
No.
No? Oh. Wait till she gets you at home. Wait till she gets older. But I want to give to your family. So you, well, first of all, one will give you a football.
The Jim Kelly football.
As you can see, Frankie's got my jersey on, and that is yesterday's game jersey against the Dolphins. As a matter of fact, that was my career high. It's the best game I've ever played as a Buffalo Bill. And fits him pretty good. Tell your sister to stay away from that. She can wear it for a dress sometime. But also, an autographed Jim Kelly football for you, Frankie. And for your parents and for your family, an autographed key holder that my father made, especially for your family. It's like Christmas in October.
Yeah. Terrific. Right. Hmm. Frankie, you think your friends are going to believe this? You think they believed it when you told them? They did? Maybe we ought to see who's going to... the rules, yeah. Before we pick next week's winner, in order to have a chance to win a Jim Kelly game jersey, write us at Jim's Jersey, and be sure to give your age. You have to be between 6 and 18 years of age. Boy or girl, that's fine. Home address, your home phone. You can only win one time, so be sure to send that to us. And once you have your entry in, you don't need to send anymore unless you want to maybe increase your chances. And there it is, Jim Kelly, WGRZ-TV, 259 Delaware, Buffalo, 14202. All right, Frankie, reach in, and let's see who next week's winner is going
to
be.
Let's try to get a girl this time.
The winner of this one, oh my gosh, a big one.
Let's see. How can you not miss? The Clydesdales.
Must be from St. Louis.
Sharon Marie Dickman of Buffalo. All right.
15 years old, all right.
15 years old. We finally got a girl. All right. Congratulations, Sharon, and we'll see you here next week.
That's right. Now, next week you play the Washington Redskins, and, hey, they sacked the quarterback 7 times against the Jets. That's
tough. I don't want to hear about that. Coach Mark Brothers, has already been watching film, and he said that their outside guys, Mann and Dexter Manley, are awesome. Plus, they have a great running cornerback in Darryl Green, which is the fastest in the NFL, and we have our hands full, but we do play at home, which is an added plus, and hopefully pulled out.
I hope so, Jim. All right, we're going to see you right here next Monday night at 7 o'clock to talk about that Redskins game and meet the next winner. We'll see you then. So long, everybody.
The Jim Kelly Show is brought to you by the Mancuso family of dealerships. Find out why Jim Kelly chose us. And by Genesee Beer. Boy, could I use a Jenny now. Guests receive a gift from Moen, who feature a full line of single and two-handle faucets with a lifetime warranty against leaks and drips. Moen, faucets for a lifetime. Transportation provided by Royal Coach Limousine Service. Ride in luxury for any occasion.